Good afternoon. I am Dr. Nori Lim from Emory University, and I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today. Dr. Julianne Holt-Lunstad is a professor of psychology and neuroscience at Brigham Young University, where she's also the director of the Social Neuroscience Lab. She received her bachelor's degree from BYU in 1994 and her PhD from the University of Utah in 2001. Dr. Holt-Lunstad is an associate editor of the International Journal of Psychophysiology and is a fellow of Association of Psychological Science. She has received the Citation Award for Excellence in Research from the Society of Behavioral Medicine, the George A. Miller Award from APA, and both the Mary Lou Fulton Young Scholar Award and the Marjorie Pei Hinckley Endowed Chair Research Award from BYU. Dr. Holt-Lunstad's research is focused on the long-term health effects of social connection. Her program of research takes an interdisciplinary and multi-level approach to understanding the association between social relationships and long-term health outcomes, factors that may moderate these associations, and the biological pathway by which these associations occur. Her work has examined the potentially detrimental influence of negativity in close relationships, such as ambivalence and marital distress. She has also begun research that examines how social relationships may be used in interventions to potentially reduce risk. Her research has been seminal in the recognition of social isolation and loneliness as a risk factor for early mortality. Dr. Holt-Lunstad's work has been highlighted in BBC's 100 Breakthrough Health Discoveries in 2015 and has been covered in the New York Times, The Washington Post, Times Magazine, Scientific America, The American Life, This American Life, The Today Show, and other major media outlets. Furthermore, she has provided expert testimony in a U.S. congressional hearing, provided expert recommendation for the U.S. Surgeon General's Emotional Well-Being in America initiative, and serves as a scientific advisor for the Australian Coalition to End Loneliness. Today, Dr. Holt-Lunstad will present her work on loneliness, entitled Loneliness, a Growing Public Threat. Please welcome Dr. Holt-Lunstad.
Thank you for the introduction, and thank you all for attending. And I want to thank APA for, of course, all the hard work that went into organizing this, and as well as recognizing this as an important topic to cover here at the convention. I also want to start by acknowledging that my remarks today will be based in part on my recent congressional testimony, as well as a paper that's in press that will be coming out next month in American Psychologist that is co-authored with Dave Sabara and Ted Robles. So I want to acknowledge their contributions to this work as well. As well as my collaborator, Tim Smith, who collaborated on some of the evidence that I'll be presenting today. I want to start off by introducing you to someone I met while preparing these remarks. This is Julio. He is one of the centenarians of the famed Blue Zones, or hotspots of longevity, in Sardinia, Italy. He is 104 years old and one of the most vibrant people I have ever met. He shops daily at the market, so I don't know if you can see in the picture, but he's got a shopping bag on his bicycle there. He cooks, he writes poetry, he stars in local theater productions, and also regularly leads off a bike annual bike race. And he rides approximately 15 kilometers a day on his bike. In fact, the morning that I met him and interviewed him, we chatted in the morning, said our goodbyes, and then I left and had lunch at a restaurant, and later went to an outdoor museum. And to my surprise, there was Julio. He had surprised us and had shown up. And when we asked him how he knew we'd be there, because we didn't even know we were going to be there, he slyly said, "I have my ways. I'm connected. There's nothing that goes on in this village that I don't know about." And so indeed, he is very connected. He has 10 children, three of which live on the same block or on the same street as he does and are very involved in his life. This is part of the culture there. It's a cultural expectation as well as considered a privilege to care for their elders. And indeed, he's referred to as Tsu Julio, the Tsu, is a term that refers to uncle. And that's a term of both respect and admiration. And it is used by not only direct family members, but the entire village. So what really stood out to me and what I thought was so remarkable about him is not just how long he's lived, which is, of course, remarkable, but just how full his life is. And he is anything but lonely. And I think what's so fascinating about him is that he's so unusual. Most older adults in the U.S., and many young adults for that matter, don't look like this. So what's his secret, right? Well, I can tell you there's no fountain of youth. I looked for it, you know, unless they're hiding it. But in all seriousness, of course, it's not just one thing, right? But when we asked him what brings him the most joy in his life, he responded that it was spending time with his family and with his friends. Now, of course, there are many, many factors that all contribute to longevity. But this leads into the topic that we're going to be talking, or that I'm going to be talking about today, and whether or not our actual relationships with others have something to do with our longevity. So to kind of take a step back, this blob on the screen is actually a flock of birds. And we see across a number of species that being part of a group serves important functions. So whether it is direction to safety, evading predators, pooling of resources, protection from the elements, reciprocal altruism, obtaining food, warmth, all of these functions are crucial to survival. This has led many to argue that social connection can be viewed as a biological need linked to survival. And much like hunger and thirst is a biological drive that motivates one to seek out food and water, that loneliness is a biological motivation to reconnect socially. Indeed, neuroscience also provides some evidence to suggest that social connections may be adaptive. For instance, when faced with a threat, we use more metabolic resources when coping with this threat when we're alone than when in the presence of others. There's also evidence to suggest that social pain shares similar neural pathways as physical pain. Both of these combined suggest that these may be biological drives that promote social connection. Indeed, isolation is also so distressing that it is often used as a form of punishment or even torture. So it's well recognized that our social relationships and being connected to others or lacking that would be connected to our psychological health or our emotional well-being. But what I'm going to present today is evidence that goes beyond emotional well-being to our physical health and even longevity. It is also well recognized that lifestyle and environmental factors play an important role in terms of our health and longevity. So this figure here represents just some of those. At the top includes smoking, alcohol, consumption, we've got physical activity here, obesity, and air pollution. And these bars represent the relative effect or impact on risk for premature mortality. We also see the CDC recognizes social determinants of health. However, if you look closely at these social determinants of health, very little emphasis is placed on actual social relationships. So it's perhaps not surprising that this is under-recognized or underappreciated by the medical community and the general public. So today, what I want to present is evidence that supports the prioritization of social connection in public health, as well as addressing potential barriers and where we go from here as a field. And so along the way, we'll be defining the issue, addressing how we deal with multiple pathways, as well as what can be done about it. But I first want to clarify by what is meant by prioritization. So when I say this, it may be met with somewhat of reactance, that this is perhaps premature or maybe naive, because many may assume that this is a call for large-scale interventions or even legislation. But really what prioritization refers to is resources, time, and energy to issues that are deemed most critical and practical to address. And so this can, of course, be used in a variety of measures, including education as well as future research. And if the evidence supports it, potential policy. So I first also want to make clear what criteria I look to in evaluating this evidence. And so I wanted to know what I'm not trained as in public health. I'm my background's in psychology, as I assume most of you are. And so I did a little digging to find out what criteria are used to determine what kinds of issues get prioritized versus other issues. Because, of course, we're dealing with limited resources, and how those resources are allocated are based on these issues. And so this is the criteria used by the CDC, which is also consistent with the criteria that is used by the World Health Organization. And the main criteria are, first, the size of the problem. So this gets at the number or percentage of people directly affected by the problem. The next is the seriousness of the problem. And the factors that are taken into account include the urgency of the issue, as well as the severity of the issue, so things such as mortality rates and economic loss. And then finally, the estimated effectiveness of the solution or how well the problem can be solved. So before we can determine the size or severity of the problem, we need to actually define what the problem is. If we look across the epidemiological evidence that supports the importance of this, we see that a wide variety of measures have been used. We have, and these can broadly be categorized into these three major headings. The first is structural measures. So these are measures that look at the existence or interconnections among different social ties or roles. So examples of this are size of social network, marital status, or living alone. The next major category of measurement could be categorized as functional measures, or the functions provided or perceived to be available by social relationships. So examples of this would be received support, perceived support, and perceived loneliness. And then finally, quality of the relationship, so the positive and negative aspects. So examples might be relationship satisfaction, conflict, and ambivalence. One thing I should mention is that all of these measurements approaches have been used in epidemiological evidence, and each of these have been linked to health outcomes, including mortality. But interestingly, there's a relatively low correlation between them, suggesting that they may have independent effects. So we really need to ask ourselves the question, what exactly is the problem? Is it having too few relationships? Is it lacking social contact or perceived support? Is it the perception of loneliness? Maybe it's lacking a close, intimate partner, or maybe it's just having someone in the home to rely upon in times of need. Or maybe it's being in a strained relationship or lacking supportive relationships. I hope you can see just from this incomplete list that this may have led to a huge barrier in this issue being prioritized because of the lack of clarity or precision in terms of what exactly the problem is. So we have proposed an umbrella term to help address this barrier. And the umbrella term that we propose is social connection, which encompasses the connections to others via the existence of relationships and their roles, the sense of connection that results from actual or perceived support or inclusion, and the sense of connection to others that's based on positive and negative qualities. So in essence, high social connection would be associated with low risk or a protective effect, whereas low social connection would be associated with greater risk. So to define the problem, or what problem we need to address, it's lacking social connection, or in other words, social disconnection. So to first determine the size of the problem, we need to determine whether there's evidence that a significant portion of the population lacks social connection. Now, given the variety of ways in which we can look at this, of course, precise estimates may be difficult to obtain. However, measures or the low end of those measures would indicate a lack of social connection. So one way to look at this is to look at the prevalence among U.S. census data. And what we find is that more than a quarter of the U.S. population lives alone. Over half of the U.S. population is unmarried. One in five have never married. And the divorce rate is around 40%. Now, of course, caution needs to be used in terms of extrapolating that these demographic factors would indicate lack of social connection because connection may occur through other means. However, these demographic factors are nonetheless very robust predictors of mortality. We can also look to data from nationally representative samples. And so for instance, data from the Pew Research Center shows that participation in social groups, the majority of Americans do not participate in social groups. So I recognize that this is rather small, but some of the groups listed include local churches, social clubs, sports leagues, youth groups, and other local groups. And the largest percentage is 46%, but the majority of them are around 15%. And so the majority are not participating in social groups. When we look specifically at perceptions of loneliness, the estimates, depending on the study, range anywhere from 20% to 43% of U.S. adults perceive that they are lonely. I have a figure here from AARP that estimates it at 35%. If we try to benchmark this relative to the proportion of U.S. adults that are affected by other factors that we take quite seriously and receive considerable attention in public health, this top orange bar is the perception of loneliness, and this other orange bar is living alone. And here we have the percentage of U.S. adults that are obese, and then we have inactivity and smoking. So we know that this exceeds the percentage of U.S. adults that are current smokers. So in essence, what the data suggests is that a significant portion of the population may be lacking social connection. To address the seriousness of the problem, we first look at indicators of urgency and whether or not there is evidence that social isolation is increasing. And there is some data that reports that since 1985, there has been a threefold decrease in the size of one's social network. If we look at census data, we see that there is a significant increase, and in fact, over the decades, this has doubled in the percentage of U.S. adults living alone. We also see significant decreases in the size of household. And although this figure is specific to women, the trends are similar for men. And what it shows is that marriage rates are declining and are currently the lowest rates in recorded history. Now, if you take this together with the increasing rate of childlessness and the increasing aging population, what this suggests is that older adults may have fewer familial resources to draw upon in older age. So we have strong evidence that a significant portion of the population lacks social connection, and it appears to be increasing. And importantly, with more systematic and representative surveillance, this could potentially be greater and more accurate. We next wanted to look at the seriousness of the problem. And the severity or risk for premature mortality. And so when we look at mortality rates, we wanted to determine the level of evidence that social connections influence longevity. And so we looked to meta-analytic data. So in essence, this is able to give us an estimate of the cumulative evidence rather than relying on any one single study. And so my colleagues and I conducted a meta-analysis in which we combined data from 148 prospective studies. And we wanted to benchmark this relative to other well-established risk factors for mortality to determine just how significant this was. So what we found in that was that that social connections had a significant impact on mortality, and it was associated with a 50% increase odds of survival. But how does that stack up to the kinds of things that are given high priority in terms of public health? And so what this figure shows is in the orange bars are indicators of social connection and these other leading health indicators. And just to put this into perspective, not only is this comparable with these well-established risk factors for mortality, including smoking up to 15 cigarettes per day, but it also exceeded the effect of many of these, including things like obesity that receives widespread attention. We were also very careful about recognizing that perhaps there are some measurement approaches that are more predictive than others. And so looking across these, I just want to point out a couple. And so one of the lowest predictors was received support. And if you can see, the confidence interval actually includes one. And that was the only one that did not reach significance. All the rest did reach significance. But it was complex measures of social integration. These include indicators across multiple domains. And that was associated with a 91% increased odds of survival. There are now many meta-analyses, including another one that I conducted that looked specifically at loneliness, social isolation, and living alone, that included over 3.4 million participants, as well as other meta-analyses done by others. And so I've tried to combine data from these different meta-analyses with the orange bars indicating a variety of measures of social connection relative to many of these other well-established risk factors. And as we can see, although they vary in their degree, they're very comparable. And while this one right here is specific to loneliness, and although it has a relatively more modest effect relative to some of the others, it's still noteworthy that this modest effect still exceeds that of both obesity and air pollution. So we have strong evidence that social connection, or the lack thereof, influences health and longevity. In other words, those who score higher on indicators of social connection are associated with reduced risk for mortality, or in other words, protection, while those who score lower are at increased risk. So the evidence is quite clear at this point in terms of the size of the problem and the severity of the problem. But the major challenge that we face at this point now is what do we do about it? The CDC has on their website a list of winnable battles. And listed among these is tobacco, nutrition, physical activity and obesity, food safety, healthcare associated infections, motor vehicle injuries, and teen pregnancy and HIV. And so the question, of course, then is, should social connection be added to this list? Well, the criteria that is used to describe these winnable battles is public health priorities with large-scale impact on health and known effective strategies to address them. Well, if we look at the first criteria, large-scale impact on health, the evidence is clear. However, when it comes to known effective strategies to address it, that's where we still face a number of challenges. So my colleagues and I are also currently working on another meta-analysis to evaluate the available evidence on interventions aimed at increasing social connection and reducing risk for mortality. I'm not going to go into detail on this because this is just preliminary data, but what I can tell you is generally characterizing this is that the evidence is mixed. There is some successful interventions, and there have been some that are less successful. And the overall effect is substantially more modest than the overall effect of the epidemiological evidence that supports it. So the important question becomes then, what works and what doesn't, given that not all efforts have been successful. But we need to be careful in terms of just throwing this under the bus, because the challenges that are faced in terms of establishing effective interventions are similarly faced for these other so-called winnable battles. So if we just take the examples of smoking and obesity, you also see large gaps between the evidence that supports that indicates a large risk associated with them and the evidence related to effectiveness of interventions. And so there are still many challenges in developing effective interventions for obesity, and there are still many challenges faced for developing interventions for smoking cessation as well. And so part of this is we need to look to these other factors and determine where, in what areas there have been most success and where there have been challenges. And one of the things to keep in mind is that many of these are multifactorial risk factors. And so what I mean by that is that there is no single putative causal mechanism. So if we just take the example of obesity, it's not just one thing that causes it. So it's related to nutrition, physical activity, genetics, environmental factors. And similarly, the influence of social relationships is complex and multifactorial. And so we need to acknowledge this and recognize that some of these mechanisms may be more modifiable than others. So we need to start conceptualizing this as a multifactorial risk or protective factor. In other words, social connection can be viewed as a protective factor, social disconnection as a risk factor. So in essence, what we need to recognize is that not only does the presence and absence of relationships matters, what they do matters, as well as the quality of these relationships. And each of these may influence risk or protection in different ways. So just to give you a sense of this, if we simply are developing interventions that increase social contact, we're really only intervening on this. We can potentially be missing risk associated with the others. And this can lead to less effective interventions. So you may be asking, well, what exactly is it, you know, are these pathways by which this leads to health and longevity? Because in order to develop effective interventions, we also need to clearly identify the causal pathways. So I'm just going to briefly highlight a few of the pathways by which our relationships may influence physical health and longevity. And one of the most widely recognized is that our relationships influence a variety of behaviors. So our relationships from the time we are little, are encouraging us to eat our vegetables, to look both ways before we cross the street. And even into adulthood, of course, it's influencing, you know, we have loved ones that encourage us to get to get more sleep or to go see the doctor when we need to. And there's a wide literature linking social relationships to promoting healthy behaviors as well as deterring risky behaviors. But I want to make sure that it's clear that while this is an important pathway, the epidemiological evidence that I presented earlier, the majority of these studies statistically controlled for many lifestyle factors. So these effects are independent of those or over and above the effect that they may have through those behavioral or lifestyle factors. Suggesting that there may be other factors at play. Some of these may be through stress reduction, a sense of safety and meaning and purpose in life, which also may have direct influence on health-relevant physiology. And this includes cardiovascular, neuroendocrine, immune functioning, as well as cellular aging. There's also evidence to suggest that this is associated with rate of cognitive decline. So this is just a simplified model of the way in which social connection, whether it is objective or subjectively measured, has an impact on lifestyle factors, psychological factors, adherence and compliance, and how these in turn may influence biomarkers that influence morbidity and mortality. So what are some of the implications for developing effective interventions? So one thing I want to make clear is that the epidemiological data is based on existing close relationships. So in my meta-analysis, we excluded any studies that were intervention-based. So these are naturally occurring relationships or close relationships. And so it's unclear to what extent this may impact support or have a similar effect with support groups or support staff. And so while, of course, there are examples of successful interventions using support groups, and support staff, there's also examples where these have not been effective. And so one potential recommendation might be that except in cases where connections are absent, that we may focus on fostering existing relationships. Another factor to consider is relationship quality. So much of the epidemiological evidence did not take relationship quality into account, and thus this evidence is likely a conservative estimate because we have evidence that strain and negativity in relationships is associated with increased risk. And if we don't take relationship quality into account when we develop an intervention, we may actually be having unintended negative effects. So even if you're fostering these relationships, including family members in the intervention, if you're not paying attention to the quality of those relationships, that may potentially reduce the effectiveness of that intervention. The next question to consider is whether we should be focusing our intervention specifically on loneliness and social isolation. And while the evidence, we found no evidence of a threshold effect, in essence it was a continuum, loneliness and social isolation are certainly on the low end of the continuum and would indicate those at greatest risk. But we need to be incredibly careful in recognizing that loneliness and social isolation are not the same thing. These often get confused and are treated as if they are synonymous. So let me explain how they are different. So social isolation refers to more of these structural aspects. So this would be having few relationships or infrequent social contact. Whereas loneliness is a subject perception of isolation, or what is often described as the discrepancy between one's desired level of social connection and one's actual level of connection. So while social isolation and loneliness can go hand in hand, they don't necessarily always go hand in hand. So for instance, you can be in a room full of people and still be lonely. Conversely, there are many people who are socially isolated, but they take pleasure in their solitude, right? So they're isolated, but they don't feel lonely. One thing to keep in mind is that both of these, both isolation and loneliness, significantly predict risk for premature mortality. And if we focus our interventions solely on increasing social contact, we may not be addressing the issue of loneliness. And so we need to be very careful about how we define our terms and how this gets translated into interventions. We also need to acknowledge that most of our existing interventions that we have developed thus far are at an individual level. And we know from other behavioral and lifestyle risk factors that individual-based interventions haven't had as much success as preventative efforts. And so we need to really look beyond just the individual level and start thinking about relationship level, community level, and societal level. So here I have a figure that in essence shows that by looking and trying to address this issue at an individual level, we're really only focusing on those at the extreme low end. And of course, this makes sense. We want to target those who are at highest risk. However, when we take this approach, we are in essence only looking at these outliers in the spectrum. And of course, the data shows that this is the effect is more of a continuous effect, and there's also available data that suggests that this is a dose response effect. And when we focus solely on deficits, we also run the risk of this being associated with shame or stigmatization. So for instance, there's already some evidence to suggest that the term lonely or loneliness is somewhat of a stigmatizing term. And instead, if we take a more of a growth approach and in promoting social connection, this is something that we all can potentially benefit from. And so instead of looking only addressing that, this is not working, the small portion of the population, we can instead potentially have a much larger effect in population-based interventions that may shift the distribution. And so similar to how the CDC addresses other public health priorities, we can take a social ecological model in developing our interventions and go beyond this individual level and start looking at interventions that are interpersonal, organizational, community, and societal. So you may be asking, well, what kinds of policies and practices can be applied? And certainly we're not recommending that we include policy for, you know, good relationships for all, but we do have some potential recommendations. And so I'm gonna go through these fairly quickly, but I'll talk a little bit more in detail on a few of these. And the first recommendation is evidence-based consensus recommendations. The second is the consideration of social connection as a multidimensional risk factor. So something akin to like a Framingham risk score for cardiovascular disease that takes into account multiple factors and not just one. We also need to have population level surveillance. And so in order to really truly get more precise estimates of who is at risk, as well as identifying potential targets for interventions, we need to have better surveillance. And the Institute of Medicine now makes recommendations for inclusion in all electronic health records. We can also turn to big data to identify specific targets of intervention that not only look at who may be in need, but also locations of where those individuals may be. As well as assembling the capability for large-scale change. So partnering with community stakeholders, as well as bridging gaps in translating basic research to widespread practice. So let me just spend a minute talking about expert consensus guidelines. So one of the things I'm often asked is, well, how do you know if you're at risk, right? And if we want this to be, if we want people to start considering their social relationships and taking them seriously for their health, just as we do others, people need to have some kind of sense of where they stand. And so just as we have recommendations about how much sleep to get or how much exercise to get, we need to have some kind of guidelines that would give some kind of estimate about both the quantity and quality of our relationships. But just like these other guidelines, this needs to be evidence-based and subject to periodic review. So as additional data becomes available, these guidelines can continue to be revised based on that. There's also potential policy and practice recommendations across settings. And we can think about this across education, workplace, healthcare, and even the built environment. So just to highlight these, in education, just as there's part of the K through 12 education, we get information about, or children are given information about exercise and nutrition, that they can get education on social skills training as well. And there are already some policies in place on anti-bullying, but of course these certainly can have additional improvement. The workplace is another setting in which we can potentially have an impact. And we already, as part of most major companies, have HR departments that help people prepare for retirement financially. And this can be a setting for which we can start helping people prepare for retirement socially as well. Also, the inclusion of family-friendly policies. And including parental and family leave. And we know that there's evidence that some of these effects can have a really early impact from infancy. And so if we want to focus on prevention, this is one way in which we can start. Another place to potentially have policy or practice is the healthcare system. And so this could be included in medical training, part of the standard medical training, so that the medical community is well informed of this data and that they can in turn use this in prevention efforts, in educating their patients, as well as early screening to identify those that may be at risk. And implement some prevention efforts before people become severely isolated or lonely. But we can also promote family or social friendly clinical policies. And so, of course, with consent, of course, there can be the inclusion of family and close relationships. I also want to mention the importance of built environment. This is something that public health takes quite seriously, but I think often gets overlooked by psychologists. And we need to recognize that our actual environment, so having a place to gather, having walkable cities, has a significant impact in terms of having a place where people gather. So having just spent time in Italy, there is these squares where everyone gathers. And so what can we do in our built environment to foster greater social interaction? And just some examples might include community gardens and rec centers, but of course there are many more. We also need to pay attention to assembling the capability for large-scale changes, and that includes partnering with community stakeholders. So AARP, their Connect to Effect program, is of course having a significant impact. In the UK, there is the Campaign to End Loneliness. But we also need to partner with the media. And so I have, you know, the example of Oprah's Just Say Hello campaign. But one of the things to recognize in terms of population level is that here in the United States, we have a social norm of independence. We value our independence. It's perhaps to our detriment. In that, instead, we need to focus more on the value of interdependence. And that seems like an insurmountable task to change cultural social norms. And yet we have examples of this where through the media, we have changed the social norms about the desirability of smoking. If you simply look at the social norms several decades ago compared to now, we can see that there has been a dramatic shift. And similarly, the media might have an impact on this. So just to conclude, I want to summarize. We have rather robust evidence now that being socially disconnected significantly increases risk for premature mortality. Conversely, being socially connected is a robust protective factor. We also have strong evidence that a significant portion of Americans are socially disconnected, and this seems to be on the rise. This is not going away, if anything, we have indicators to suggest this is getting worse. And although the interventions to reduce risk have mixed evidence, this is not an insurmountable challenge. And through greater prioritization and greater resources, we can tackle this public health issue. We now have what is often being called here in the United States a loneliness epidemic. So not only in the United States, but the UK, the Australia, Germany, these are all nations that have suggested that we are facing a loneliness epidemic. And it's only through sustained efforts and prioritization in public health that we will be able to tackle this important problem. Thank you.